हेलो एवरीवन, आई वेलकम यू टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल प्रोफेसर सिविल मंडल। हियर आई बेसिकली स्पीक अबाउट सिविल इंजीनियरिंग एंड यू विल फाइंड ऑल माय वीडियो लेक्चर्स रिगार्डिंग सिविल इंजीनियरिंग ओवर हियर। इन दिस वीडियो आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक अबाउट द हाईवे मटेरियल्स। सो आफ्टर वी हैव लर्नड अबाउट द जियोमेट्रिक डिज़ाइन, द हाईवे प्लानिंग एंड अलाइनमेंट, the traffic studies and also the history of road construction, now we are going to study about the materials which we will be using for making highway. Okay, so you know there are three basic materials, that is the subgrade soil, the aggregates and bitumen, which are used. Subgrade soil is basically the lowermost layer which is for the support of the soil. Next comes the layer of aggregates which form as the base course, and finally the bitumen which is used on the surface. So reading about the subgrade soil, it is the supporting soil beneath pavement and its special under courses is called subgrade. So in other words, you also know it as the subgrade. It is simply known as the subgrade. So the compacted subgrade is the soil compacted by controlled movement of heavy compactors. So the controlled movement of heavy compactors actually compact the subgrade, and this compaction is very necessary for a stability of the pavement and achieving proper designing factors. The desirable properties of subgrade of the soil are like this: stability, it should be stable; incompressibility, permanency of the strength, the strength should be permanent, it's not like it will be weird and teared as the time passes by; minimum changes in volume and stability under adverse conditions of weather and ground. Whatever might be the condition, there must be no change in the volume. So you can guess by the cross section of a road, if there is any change in the volume, it will be creating pressure on the upper layers and thus will be getting cracks and potholes over the road. Also, good drainage must be maintained so that water doesn't stays over it and causes the bulking, and also the compaction shall be easy, that the soil must be easily compacted, can be easily compacted to a certain amount. So about the first test, this is the California bearing ratio test. Actually in this chapter we will be studying various tests related to the highway material, and California bearing ratio test is one test which is done with soils. This particular test is also studied in geotechnical engineering or soil mechanics. This California bearing ratio test was developed by California Division of Highway as a method of classifying and evaluating soil subgrade and base course for flexible pavements. So this was done by the California Division of Highway for classifying and evaluating the soil subgrade and base course material for flexible pavement. So what is the procedure? The laboratory CBR apparatus consists of a mold 150 mm. So in the 150 mm diameter mold, base plate and collar is also there, and loading frame and dial gauges for measuring the penetration values and the expansion or the soaking. So let me show you the diagram. Here it is. So this is the diagram for the apparatus, and that is this mold. This is the mold of 150 mm dia, and there's a particular plate and a collar. So this is the plate on which the mold is kept, and this is the collar over which this plunger is being acted. Next, the specimen in the mold is soaked in water for 4 days, and the swelling and water absorption values are noted. So first, the specimen is soaked and kept in water, and the water absorption values are noted. The surcharge weight is placed on the top of the specimen in the mold, and the assembly is placed under the plunger of the loading frame. So the surcharge weight is placed on the top of the specimen and the mold in the mold, and the assembly is placed under the plunger of the loading frame. So see in the diagram, here the soil sample is placed, and then a surcharge weight is applied under the plunger. Next, the load is applied on the sample by a standard plunger of dia 50 mm at the rate of 125 mm per minute. A load penetration curve is drawn. The values on the standard stones are 1370 and 2055 kg at 2.5 mm and 5 mm penetrations respectively. So for 2.5 mm we will use 1370, for 2.5 mm and for 5 mm we will use 2055 kg. The CVR value is expressed as a percentage of the actual loading causing the penetrations of 2.5 or 5 mm to the standard loads mentioned above. So this is the formula. CVR is equal to the load carries by specimen upon the load carries by standard specimen over times the 100. Two values of CVR will be obtained. If the values of 2.5 mm is greater than the rate of 5 mm penetration, the former is adopted. So we adopt the value which is greater, both for 2.5 mm and for 5 mm. Whichever will be the greater value, we will adopt that one. And if the CVR value obtained from test at 5 mm penetration is higher than that of 2.5 mm, then the test is to be repeated for checking. If the check test again receives similar test, then higher value at 5 mm penetration is reported as the CVR value. So if the check test again gives similar results, then we shall give a higher value obtained at 5 mm penetration as reported as a CVR value. The average CVR value of the three test specimens is reported as the CVR value of the sample. So the three test specimens, whatever CVR values will be coming, we will take the average and we will report them as the CVR value. So you can note the diagram. Also, the notes will be given, and the link for the notes is given in the description. So you need not to worry about the figure a lot. Let's move on to the next test, that is the plate load test. The plate bearing test is also known as the plate bearing test. Just keep it in mind. Plate load test is also known as the plate bearing test, and it is used to evaluate the support capability of subgrades. It is used to evaluate the support capability of subgrades, bases, and in some cases the complete pavement. So with the help of this test, we actually find the capability of subgrades, bases, and in some cases the complete pavement. We actually try to get the strength of the whole entire pavement, actually you can say. See, they are taking it for subgrades, base, so you can consider the whole pavement. The test site is prepared and loose material is removed so that 75 cm of diameter test plate rests horizontally in full contact with the soil subgrade. So we will remove the loose material of the topsoil, that is by 75 cm, and the diameter plate and the 75 cm diameter plate rests horizontally in full contact with the soil subgrade. So as we know that the top layer of the soil is loose as compared to the bottom layers, so we will remove the loose layer first, and then we will conduct the experiment on some deeper layer which is actually much more compacted. The plate is seated accurately and then a seating load equivalent to a pressure of 0.07 kg per centimeter square, that is 320 kg for 75 centimeter diameter plate, is applied and released after a few seconds. The settlement dial gauge is now set corresponding to zero load. So we will tap it to zero load so that we can start the reading, start taking readings from fresh zero. Next is the load is applied by means of jack sufficient to cause an average settlement of about 0.25 centimeter. So we will take a jack and the load is applied so that the average settlement of 0.25 centimeter is formed. When there is no perceptible increase in settlement or when the rate of settlement is less than 0.025 mm per minute, in that case the soils with high moisture content or in clay soils. Suppose in clay soil this thing will be happening, that the settlement will be less, because in sands we get higher settlements at the beginning. The load dial reading and the settlement dial readings are noted. The deflection of the plate is measured by the means of deflection dials. So deflection dials will be there, yeah, like this one. This will note the deflection and placed usually at 1/3 point of the plate near its outer edge. So it is placed in the outer edge and near the 1/3 length of the plunger. Next, to minimize bending, a series of stacked plates should be used. To minimize bending, we use a series of stacked plates and average of 3 or 4 settlement dial readings is taken as the settlement of the plate corresponding to the applied load. So we will take 3 or 4 readings and we will report the average of those 4 settlements as the final settlement corresponding to the plate, final settlement of the plate corresponding to the applied load. The load is then increased till the average settlement increase to a further amount of 0.25 mm. So as and when we reach a settlement of 0.25 mm, we try to settle it more, and the load and average settlement readings are noted as before. The procedure is repeated till the settlement is 1.75 centimeter. So we continuously keep on giving 0.25 mm settlements until the total settlement is about 1.75 centimeter. So assuming that the subgrid is an elastic medium with modulus of elasticity ES, we therefore get the deformation in the plate as this one. Del is equal to 1.118 times PA upon E, where A is the radius of rigid plate in centimeter and delta is the deformation of plate in centimeter. Hence K is equal to ES upon 1.18 A, or K1A1 equal to K2A2. Aggregates. Next is the aggregates. So after we are done with the soil testing, next is the time for the aggregates, and these are the tests which we do in the highway engineering laboratories. So in many colleges these state tests are performed in the highway engineering laboratories. All the tests relating to the aggregates and bitumens, and the colleges mainly focus on these tests because these tests are also very important from the field point of view. So aggregate is a collective term for the mineral material such as sand, gravel and crushed stones that are used as the binding material. So desirable properties are that it should have proper strength, it should have proper hardness, it should be tough to wear and tear, it should have a proper shape, neither too long, neither too flaky, it should have some addition with bitumen or asphalt what we are using as the binding material. It should be durable and freedom from deleterious particles like soil, mud, etc. The extra particles like soil or mud are known as the deleterious particles. So the aggregates must be free from those type of particles. So first test is a very popular test known as the crushing test. So the crushing value, aggregate crushing value provides a relative measure of resistance to crushing under gradually applied crushing load. The test consists of subjecting the specimen of aggregate in standard mold to a compression test under standard loading condition. So for this, we use dry aggregates through 12.5 mm sieves and retained in 10 mm sieves are filled in cylindrical measures of 11.5 mm diameter and 18 cm in height in 3 layers. So the aggregates which are restricted by 12.5 mm and 10 mm sieves, so you can get the size range of the aggregates, and that they are filled in the cylindrical measure of dia 11.5 mm and height 18 cm, and it is done in 3 layers with proper compaction. Each layer is tempered 25 times using standard tamping rod, and then the test sample is weighed and placed in the test cylinder in 3 layers, each layer being tempered again and again. The specimen is subjected to a compressive load of 40 tons gradually, so at the rate of 4 tons per minute. So we will place this apparatus with 3 layers tamped with aggregates of size 12.5 to 10 mm, and we will place this apparatus under the compression testing machine. We will apply a total load of 40 tons, and it will be done gradually by applying load of 4 tons per minute. So you can guess hardly 10 minutes will be enough for crushing the aggregates. Then the crushed aggregates are then sieved through 2.36 mm. The crushed particles will be sieved through this 2.36 mm. And the weight of the passing material W2 is expressed as percentage of the weight of the total sample. So the total sample which we'll be taking will be weighed as W1, and W2 will be the weight of the passing material through 2.36 mm sieve. And these are the crushed aggregates. So the aggregate crushing value is given by W1 by W2 times 100. A value less than 10 signifies an exceptionally strong aggregate, and while above 35 would normally be regarded as weak aggregates and are generally rejected for road constructions. So this is the figure of the test apparatus. Aggregates are placed in the mold like this, of diameter 154 mm and height almost 18 cm. Next is the abrasion test. The abrasion test is carried out to test the hardness property of the aggregates and to decide whether they are suitable for different pavement construction works. So Los Angeles abrasion test will be the one which we will be reading here, and is the most popular test out of the other tests. So Los Angeles test is also standardized for India, IS 2386 part 4. Los Angeles machine consists of the circular drum of internal dia 700 mm and length 520 mm mounted on horizontal axis, enabling it to be rotated. An abrasive charge consisting of cast iron spherical balls of 48 mm diameters and weigh 340 to 445 gram is placed in the cylinder along with the aggregates. So there will be a big cylinder where we will be placing the aggregates, and After we have placed the aggregates, we will take small balls of diameter 48 mm and weight 340 to 455 gram. These are basically known as the charges, and this will be placed in the cylinder consisting the aggregates and the number of abrasive spares. The number of abrasive spares varies according to the grading of the sample. The quantity, again, this thing is suggested by various quotes which are available freely on the internet, and we will be putting that many number of abrasive spares depending upon the grading of the sample, or that is the aggregates. The quantity of aggregates to be used depends upon the gradation and usually ranges from 5 to 10 kg. Again, this also depends upon the gradation of the aggregates. The cylinder is then locked and rotated at a speed of 30 to 33 rpm for a total of 500 to 1000 revolutions. So we will rotate this thing is machine operated totally and will be rotated 30 to 33 rpm for a total of 500 to 1000 revolutions depending upon the gradation of aggregates. Again, we depend upon the gradation of aggregates. After the specified revolution, the material is then sieved up through 1.7 mm sieve. Previously it was 2.36 mm sieve for crushing test. For abrasion test we use 1.7 mm sieve, and the past fraction is expressed as percentage total weight of the sample. This value is known as the Los Angeles abrasion value. So the past weight through the 1.7 mm sieve is referred as the Los Angeles abrasion value. A maximum value of 40% is allowed for WBM base. So 40% for WBM base coarse. In Indian conditions for bituminous it is 35. So this is the figure of the sphere where the charges and the aggregates are placed, and this is given the particular rotations. Next is the impact test. The aggregate impact test is carried out to evaluate the resistance. In other words, the wearing and tearing of the aggregates. So you can get the idea of the type of loads that a road is subjected to whenever heavy vehicles are coming through it. See, the presence of heavy vehicle can crush the aggregates. They can abrade them also. They can, even in various jerks, when the traffic is also subjected to various jerks, the road will be subjected to impact loads, and thus the impact test is very necessary. The aggregate impact test is carried out to evaluate the resistance to impact of aggregates. The aggregates passing 12.5 mm sieve and retained on 10 mm sieve is filled in cylindrical steel cup of diameter 10.2 and depth 5 cm, which is attached to a metal base of testing machine. So just see the figure. There's a circular base and the cylindrical steel cup with inner surface case hardened and here we have the hammer, and this is the mechanism for dropping the hammer. So we will pull by using this one and we will drop the hammer as soon as it reaches this height. So the material is filled in three layers where each layer is tamped for 25 number. And metal hammer of weight 13.55 to 14 kg is arranged to drop with a free fall of 38 cm by vertical guides, and the test specimen is subjected to 15 number of blows. So दिस मेटेलिक हैमर विल बी एट अ हाइट ऑफ 38 सेंटीमीटर फ्रॉम द सैम्पल एंड दिस वेज द वेट ऑफ दिस वन इज 13.5 to 14 kg एंड 15 नंबर ऑफ ब्लोस फॉर द पर्टिकुलर टेस्ट. द क्रस्ट एग्रीगेट इज अलाउड टू पास थ्रू 2.36 mm सीव एंड द इम्पैक्ट वैल्यू इज मेजर्ड एज अ परसेंटेज ऑफ एग्रीगेट पासिंग W2 टू द टोटल वेट W1. सो हेयर अगेन इट इज एज सिमिलर एज द क्रशिंग वैल्यू टेस्ट. नेक्स्ट फॉर द साउंडनेस टेस्ट, साउंडनेस इज इंटेंडेड टू स्टडी द रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ एग्रीगेट्स टू वेदरिंग एक्शंस बाय कंडक्टिंग एक्सीलरेटेड वेदरिंग टेस्ट साइकिल्स. सो द पोरस एग्रीगेट्स आर सब्जेक्टेड टू फ्रीजिंग एंड थॉइंग एंड आर लाइकली टू डिसइंटीग्रेट प्रीमैच्योरली. टू एसर्टेन द ड्यूरेबिलिटी ऑफ सच एग्रीगेट्स दे आर सब्जेक्टेड टू एन एक्सीलरेटेड साउंडनेस एज स्पेसिफाइड इन IS 236-386 Part 5. सो एज यू नो द वेदर्स द रोड्स आर सब्जेक्टेड टू वेरियस वेदरिंग एक्शंस लाइक विंड वाटर एटसेट्रा एंड थस द हाईवे इंजीनियर्स नीड टू परफॉर्म सम टेस्ट रिगार्डिंग दिस थिंग ऑल्सो. सो द साउंडनेस टेस्ट इज एक्चुअली मेंट फॉर चेकिंग द वेदरिंग एक्शंस द ड्यूरेबिलिटी और द रेजिस्टेंस ऑफ द एग्रीगेट्स टू वेरियस वेदरिंग एक्शंस बाय कंडक्टिंग एक्सीलरेटेड वेदरिंग टेस्ट लाइक फ्रीजिंग थॉविंग एटसेट्रा एज सजेस्टेड बाई IS 2386 Part 5. Aggregates of specified size are subjected to cycles of alternate wetting in a saturated solution of either sodium sulfate or magnesium sulfate for 16 to 18 hours and then dried in an oven for 105 to 110 degree centigrade. So, the aggregates of the specified size are used for alternate wetting in a sodium sulfate or magnesium sulfate solution for 16 to 18 hours and then they are kept in oven for getting dried to 105 to 110 degree centigrade. So after first five cycles, the loss in weight of the aggregates is determined by sieving out all the undersized particles and weighing. So placing these aggregates in two adverse situations, we will see the amount being weathered and the undersized particles are weighed and the loss in the weight should not exceed 12%. So after this putting in adverse things is done, we check the weight of the aggregates and upon checking the weight of the aggregates, we try to denote the amount of the undersized particles and thus this loss should also not exceed 12% when tested with sodium sulfate and 18% with magnesium sulfate. So if this is not exceeded by 12% or 18%, then we can say the aggregate is sound to weathering. Next is the shape test. So shape test is basically done with the help of these two apparatus. One is for elongation and another is for the flakiness. Let's read about them. The particle shape of the aggregate is determined by the percentage of flaky and elongated particles in it. Aggregates which are flaky or elongated are detrimental or higher workability and stability of mixtures. The flakiness index is defined as a percentage by weight of aggregate particles whose least dimension is less than 0.6 times their mean size. So this is the definition of flakiness index, that is द परसेंटेज ऑफ बाय वेट ऑफ एग्रीगेट्स एग्रीगेट पार्टिकल्स हुज लीस्ट डायमेंशन इज लेस देन 0.6 टाइम्स देयर मीन साइज द टेस्ट सो द पार्टिकल्स वन डायमेंशन शुड नॉट बी 0.6 टाइम्स लेसर देन द मीन साइज सो इफ वी कंसिडर अ पर्टिकुलर एग्रीगेट एंड इन द थ्री डायमेंशंस एक्स वाई एंड जेड इन द लीस्ट डायमेंशन शुड नॉट बी लेस देन 0.6 एज 0.6 ऑफ देयर मीन साइज The test procedure is standardized in IS 2386 part 1. 2:4 flakiness index The elongation index is an aggregate of an aggregate is defined as a percentage by weight of particles whose greatest dimension that is the length is 1.8 times their mean dimension. So, in elongation index, we check the greatest dimension and it should be 1.8 times their mean dimension. This test is applicable to aggregates larger than 6.3 mm. This test is also specified in IS 2386 part 1. However, there are no recognized limits for the elongation index. So this apparatus is used for the elongation index and this one is used for the flakiness index. So this test defines that the particles passing through this one cannot be used for road construction. That is, the particle should not be very much flaky. And on the other hand, the particles should be able to pass through these ones. That is, the elongated ones are not taken and the particles is thus should not be very much elongated. So this shape test actually means that a particle should not be very much flaky or very much elongated if it has to be suitable for road construction. Next is the specific gravity test. So the specific gravity test for this about 2 kg of aggregate sample is washed thoroughly to remove fines and drained and placed in the wire basket and immersed in distilled water at a temperature 22 to 32 degrees centigrade. A cover of at least 5 cm of water above the top of the basket. So we first wash off the finer particles and 2 kg of this aggregate sample is taken and immersed in distilled water at 22 to 32 degrees centigrade and the whole thing is taken in a wired basket. As you know, wired basket is used for in the specific gravity test apparatus. So the immediately after the immersion, the entrapped air is removed from the sample by lifting the basket containing it 25 mm above the base of the tank. So first we try to remove the entrapped air by lifting it by 25 mm and allowing it to drop at the rate of 1 drop per second. So we are then dropping it at the rate of 1 drop per second. The basket and aggregate should remain completely immersed in water for a period of 24 hours afterwards. So later on it should be immersed for a period of 24 hours. The basket and the sample are weighed with suspended in water at a temperature of 22 to 32 degrees centigrade. Then again, while suspended in water, the weight is again taken and it is noted as W1G. The basket and the aggregates are removed from the water and allowed to drain for a few minutes, after which the aggregates are transferred to the dry absorbent clothes. So after these are removed from the basket and the aggregates are then transferred to a dry absorbent cloth so that the moisture is taken up. So the use of this absorbent cloth is for drying up the moisture over the surface of the aggregates, and then you can say that it is air dried. Okay, and this the empty basket is then returned to the tank of the water and jolted 25 times, so and weighed in water, that is W2 gram. So this is the weight of the basket in water. Actually previously it was the weight of the basket along with aggregates in water, and this is the weight of the solely the weight of the basket in water. The aggregate placed on the absorbent clothes are surface dried till no further moisture could be removed by the cloth. So first it is surface dried till no moisture is removed by the cloth. Then the aggregates are transferred to the second dry cloth spread in the single layer and allowed to dry for at least 10 minutes. So this drying process is done in two steps in two separate cloths so that proper drying is ensured. Proper air drying is ensured. In minutes until the aggregates are completely surface dry, the surface dried aggregate are then weighed as W3 gram. So this is the weight of the surface dried aggregates. Then finally the aggregate is placed in shallow tray and kept in an oven at the temperature of 100 degree centigrade for 24 hours. And after it is dried, after 24 hours we take this weight, that is W4 gram, and it is the oven dried weight. So these are the observations. W1g is the saturated aggregate suspended. Why it is saturated? Because it was present in water along with the basket. So weight of the basket suspended in water is W2g, and weight of the saturated surface dry aggregate in air is W3 gram, oven dried W4 gram, and weight of the saturated aggregate is W1 minus WG. So as you know, W1G is the weight of the water plus aggregate. So if we reduce the weight of the water, then we will get the weight of the aggregate. It is by simple mathematics we can say that. So from W1 if we subtract W2, so then it will give only the weight of the saturated aggregate in water by removing the weight of the basket. So weight of the water equal to the volume of the aggregate is W3 minus W1 minus W2. So now W3 is the weight of the surface dried aggregates. So W3 minus W1 minus W2 will give the weight of the water equal to the volume of the aggregate. So these are the formulas for specific gravity, apparent specific gravity, and water absorption. So finally, we arrive to the tests related to bitumen after we are done with the aggregates and the soil. So for bitumen, we do penetration test. It measures the hardness or softness of bitumen by measuring the depth in tenths of the millimeter to which the standard loaded needle will penetrate vertically in 5 seconds. So in penetration test, what we do, we take bitumen sample and try to penetrate a needle through it. So it is the measure of the depth. The needle will penetrate vertically in 5 seconds. So BIS has standardized the equipment and test procedure, and the penetrometer consists of, it is known as penetrometer, right? It consists of a needle assembly with a total weight of 100 gram and a device for releasing and locking in any position. The bitumen is softened to a pouring consistency, stirred thoroughly, and poured into containers at a depth at least 15 mm. So The bitumen, after being softened to a pouring consistency, they start thoroughly and poured into containers at a depth of at least 15 mm. So the containers should have depth of at least 15 mm, so that the test should be conducted at, and also the test should be conducted at a temperature of 25 degree centigrade. It may be noted that the penetration value is largely influenced by any inaccuracy with regards to the pouring time. Whatever, let's move on. A grade of 40 to 50 bitumen means the penetration value is in the range of 40 to 50 at standard test condition. This is the apparatus. Next is the ductility test. So you know, ductility is the property by which anything can be drawn into thinner, or it can be drawn into smaller of thinner wires or wires of less diameter. So this is the property of ductility, and it is very much shown in metals. So also this thing is also shown by bitumen, and that permits it to undergo greater deformation or elongation. Therefore, by this property, it can undergo elongations. The ductility is defined as the distance in centimeter to which a standard sample or briquette of the material will be elongated without breaking. So this is also important, that it shouldn't be broken. So, and ductility is thus defined as the distance in centimeter to which a standard sample or briquette of the material will be elongated without breaking. Thus, dimension of the briquette thus formed is exactly 1 centimeter square. The bitumen sample is heated and poured in the mold assembly placed on a sample. These samples with molds are cooled in air and then in water bath at 27 degree centigrade temperature. The excess bitumen is cut and the surface is leveled using a hot knife. So the excess bitumen will be cut using the hot knife, and then the mold will, with the assembly containing sample, is kept in water bath of ductility machine for about 90 minutes. The sides of the molds are removed, the clips are hooked on the machine, and the machine is operated. The distance up to the point of the breaking of thread is the ductility value, which is reported in centimeters. So upon constant pulling up the bitumen sample, of the thread of the bitumen sample will be breaking at a certain point, and thus that will be reported in centimeter. That particular length, sorry, it will be reported in centimeter. The ductility value gets affected by factors such as pouring temperature, test temperature, the rate of pulling, etc. So these are the factors which actually affect the ductility value. A minimum ductility value of 75 centimeter has been specified by the BIS, and the figure below shows the ductility molds to be filled with bitumen. So this is the starting point, this is the end point until it breaks, and thus ductility is given by this particular elongation. Next is the softening point test. It denotes the temperature at which the bitumen attains a particular degree of softening under the specification of the test. The test is conducted by using ring and ball apparatus. A brass ring containing test sample of bitumen is suspended in liquid like water or glycerin at a given temperature. A steel ball is placed upon the bitumen sample and the liquid medium is heated at rate of 5 degree C per minute. The temperature is noted when the soft end bitumen touches the metal plate, which is at a specified distance below. Generally, higher softening point indicates lower temperature susceptibility and is preferred in hot climates. So this is the figure for softening point test. Just go through it. Next we have similar specific gravity test, just like the aggregates. And the specific gravity of bitumen varies from 0.97 to 1.02. Viscosity test, you know, viscosity and viscosity denotes the proper fluid property of the bituminous material, and it is a measure of resistance to flow. So every liquid, when it is flowing, it will, the layers of the fluid will show some resistance to flow. So this is known as the viscosity. So bitumen being fluidic in nature, it will also show some viscosity, and it influences the strength of the resulting paving mixture. Okay, the more will be the viscosity, the more will be the strength of the paving mixtures. Of course, the lesser fluidic nature will yield to more strength. At high viscosity, it resists the compactive effort, and thereby resulting mix is heterogeneous, hence low stability values. And at low viscosity, instead of providing a uniform film over aggregates, it will lubricate the aggregate particles. Orifice type viscometers are used to indirectly find the viscosity of liquid binders like cutbacks and emulsions. The viscosity is expressed in seconds, is the time taken by the 50 ml bitumen material to pass through the orifice of a cup under standard test conditions and specified temperature. The viscosity of a cutback can be expressed with either 4 mm orifice at what is given, I don't know, I think 25 degree centigrade, or 10 mm orifice at 25 or 40 degree centigrade. Next is the flash and fire point test. So at high temperatures, the depending upon the grades of bitumen, material leaves out the volatiles, and this volatile catches fire, which is very hazardous, and therefore it is essential to qualify the temperature. Qualify this temperature for each bitumen grade. BI is defined the flash point. Flash point is the temperature at which the vapor of bitumen momentarily catches fire in the form of flash under specific test conditions. The fire point is defined as the lowest temperature under which specified test condition at which the bituminous material gets ignited and burns. So you now know the difference between the flash point and the fire point. Next is the float test. So it can be measured either by penetration test or viscosity test. The apparatus consists of an aluminium float and a brass collar filled with bitumen to be tested. The specimen in the mold is cooled at a temperature of 5 degrees centigrade and screwed to the float. The total assembly is floated in the water bath at 50 degrees centigrade, and the time required for water to pass its way through the specimen plug is noted and is expressed as the float value. So the apparatus will be floating on water, and while it is floating, the time taken to pass the water through the specimen plug is noted in seconds. And it is expressed as a float value. Next is the water content test. So it is desirable that the bitumen contains minimum water content to prevent foaming of the bitumen when it is heated above the boiling point of water. So actually bitumen foams when it is heated at over the boiling point of water. So the water in the bitumen is determined by mixing known weight of specimen in a pure petroleum distillate free from water heating and distilling of the water. The weight of the water condensed and collected is expressed as a percentage by weight of the original sample. The allowable maximum water content should not be more than 0.2% by weight. Last is the loss on heating test. When the bitumen is heated, it loses the volatility and gets hardened. About 50 gram of the sample is weighed and heated to a temperature of 163 for 5 hours. The sample specimen is weighed again after the heating period, and loss in weight is expressed as a percentage by weight of the original sample. The bitumen used in the pavement mixture should not indicate more than 1% loss in weight, but for bitumen having penetration values 150 to 200 up to 2% loss in weight is allowed. So this was all about the highway materials and the testing related to it. So if you have any doubts, I don't think you should have any doubts regarding this topic, because it is totally theoretical and doesn't require much help in understanding. But still then, if you have any doubts, please don't hesitate to post in the comment section. Also, like and share my video and subscribe to the channel if you are new. Thank you.